wet ever candlelight, painted against the sky. Wise men searching for the holy child. One king held the frankincense, one king held the myrrh, one king held the purest gold, one king held the hope of the world.
Please stand this time for a call to worship. Matthew 1, verses 22 and 23. Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. See, the virgin will become pregnant and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel. Opening chorus as we adore you.
Child Emmanuel,
Heavenly Father, we again thank you for this day. Thank the opportunity we have to be here. We praise you for who you are. We're so thankful for your Son that you did send him to us. We ask now that you give us listening ears as we go into our service this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And one thing, just as the shepherds and all those around that time, we are so joyful about what Jesus meant to each and every day. Psalm title says, we Christian men rejoice. Song says Silent Night. We're not sure if it's really a silent night with the shepherds and the angels and all that was going on, but we like to think of it that way since it was a special time when Jesus Christ came into the world. Silent Night. Oh, story is grand and profound. God incarnate, born to live as a man, born to die, born to be resurrected, both God and man. These are the things we think about from Mama Gore's take.
Passages of Scripture. One in the Old Testament, two in the New. We've been going through the book of Exodus. And I'm going to start there. Exodus chapter 6. Verses 6 through 8. Therefore, tell the Israelites, I am Yahweh, and I will deliver you from the forced labor of the Egyptians, and free you from slavery to them. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and great acts of judgment. I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. You will know that I am Yahweh, your God, who delivered you from the forced labor of the Egyptians. I will bring you to the land that I swore to give to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I will give it to you as a possession. I am Yahweh. Then over to the book of John, chapter 16. John chapter 16, starting with verse 5. This is Jesus speaking right before he went to the cross. But now I'm going away to him who sent me, and not one of you asked me, where are you going? Yet because I have spoken these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I'm telling you the truth. It is for your benefit that I go away. Because if I don't go away, the counselor will not come to you. If I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will convict the world about sin, righteousness, and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will no longer see me. And about judgment, because the ruler of this world has been judged. And finally, we're going to jump over to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. But you, that's everyone here who is a Christian, but you are a chosen race, a chosen generation, a chosen nation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for, New American Standard says, God's own possession. So that you may proclaim his praises, his excellencies, of the one who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received it. We're starting to look at the Bible school hour, starting to look at the plagues, came upon Egypt. God proved his majesty against the gods of Egypt. He said, I will redeem you and I will take you as my people and I will be your God. Passage from John was right before Jesus' crucifixion. Think about it. Satan thought he had won. Yet what he did was steal his own condemnation. Jesus' righteousness was proven. He went back to the Father. Mankind's sinfulness was proven. We were given a decision to make. Jesus had said earlier, you find that in the 12th chapter, if I'm lifted up, I will draw all men to myself. We either accept or we reject him as Lord and Savior. And God's mighty acts and his outstretched arm, I'm going to say, are still happening today. Every time someone accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior, God's power is revealed. More so today in the spiritual realm. So we have to stop and think about it. It's not as obvious as the Nile turning to blood, the gnats, the swarms of insects. But it's no less significant. We are God's people. We have received his mercy. We are royalty. But only because of Jesus' sacrifice. And that is why we meet around this table. To remember what he did. That he wants us to join him in fellowship for eternity. Dear Lord, in prayer. Our God, we thank you for your great love, your great plan. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for loving us. As we partake of these emblems, may we more fully understand the greatness of your plan and your power and what you've done. So in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
stand as I read this morning's scripture. Exodus chapter 24, covenant ceremony. Then he said to Moses, "Go up to the Lord, you, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of Israel's elders, and bow and worship at a distance. Moses alone is to approach the Lord, but the others are not to approach, and the people are not to go up with him." Moses came and told the people all the commands of the Lord, all the ordinances. Then all the people responded with a single voice, "We will do everything that the Lord has commanded." And Moses wrote down all of the words of the Lord. He rose early the next morning and set up an altar and 12 pillars for the 12 tribes of Israel at the base of the mountain. Then he set out young Israelite men, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord. Moses took half of the blood and set it in basins, and the other half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. Then he took the covenant scroll and read it aloud to the people. They responded, "We will do and obey everything that the Lord has commanded." Moses took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, "This is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you concerning all of these words." Then Moses went up with Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of Israel's elders, and they saw the God of Israel. Beneath his feet was something like a pavement made of sapphire, stone, as clear as the sky itself. God did not harm the Israelite nobles. They saw him, and they ate and drank. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and stay there, so that I may give you the stone tablets with the law and the commandments I have written for their instruction." So Moses arose with his assistant Joshua and went up the mountain of God. He told the elders, "Wait here for us until we return to you. Aaron and Hur are here with you. Whoever has a dispute should go up to them." When Moses went up the mountain, cloud covered it. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called Moses from the cloud. The appearance of the Lord's glory to the Israelites was like a consuming fire on the mountain. Moses entered the cloud as he went up the mountain, and he remained on the mountain 40 days. Children are dismissed at this time.
Just check and see if you have my name up here.
Sorry.
Where I was supposed to stand this morning.
You can stand on that line right there. That's where the little ones
to stay in the directions.
Yeah, I didn't stay on it too well.
Yeah, I probably wouldn't either. I'm excited for it tonight. I am giddy with anticipation. See all of you little ones, all their hard work and effort to watch the parents nervously watch their children on stage. Good to see y'all this morning. Appreciate Brother Mike filling in for me last Sunday morning. I also appreciate Mike, you mentioned the fact that Navy beat Army. Glad you included that last week. Good thing. Hayden likes that. I do appreciate Brother Mike preaching last Sunday morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we come to you this morning. Father, we want to thank you for today. Father, we are not promised tomorrow. Our neighbors in a state close by went to bed and died. Didn't live to see something. So, Father, in times like this, may we take the time to slow down and be thankful for today. Thankful for the gift of life today. Father, we understand that you have created all things. And that includes us. Father, help us to see that we have value and worth. Father, help us also to see that that value and worth ultimately exists to honor and glorify you. Father, we're in that time of year when we're so busy. Father, may we be intentional to focus on what really matters. And that is you and you alone. Father, we love you. And we're thankful that you are the way that you are. And we're thankful, Father, that you have redeemed us so that we can be in fellowship with you. And Father, we're holding on to the promise that one day Jesus will come and all of this will come to an end. You burned up with fire, that you will construct a new earth in which we can have perfect fellowship with you for all eternity. Father, as we approach your scripture this morning, we ask, Lord, that you forgive us of our sins. And we ask, Lord, that you forgive us in the exact same way give those who sin against us. These things we ask in Jesus. Amen. All right, great study of scriptures this morning. We're in Ecclesiastes chapter 2. We're going to be looking this morning at verses 24 through 26. And what we're going to see here begins somewhat of a transition. Because what we're going to see this morning is what Solomon has discovered. And then that is going to be a natural segue into chapter 3. So the end of chapter 2 ties together 2, but it also ties together chapter 3. So here's what Solomon has to say to us this morning. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 24 through 26. There is nothing better for man than to eat, drink, and enjoy his work. I have seen that even this is from God's hand. Because who can eat and who can enjoy life apart from him?
or to the man who is pleasing in his sight. He gives wisdom, knowledge, and joy. But to the sinner, he gives the task of gathering and accumulating in order to give to the one who is pleasing in God's sight. This too is heaven and the pursuit of the wind. Let me ask you a question this morning. How does man find happiness and contentment in a sin-sick, cursed world? How do we find it? How do we find that sense of self-satisfaction? How can we find happiness? How is it possible that we can choose joy? How is it that we can be content in this sin-sick world, in the cursed world? And this is a question that we have to ask and answer. Because the world needs to know the answer to this question. Because first of all, we need to understand that this world is cursed. We all, as humanity, live under a curse. All of creation is under a curse. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. We looked at this early on in our discussion of Ecclesiastes. Creation and Ecclesiastes are tied together. Genesis chapter 3. Listen to what God says to Adam after they rebelled against God. Genesis 3, starting in verse number 17. And he said to Adam, because you listened to your wife's voice and ate from the tree about which I commanded you, do not eat from it. So Adam had a choice, didn't he? And Adam activated his free will. Now what happened? Because Adam activated his free will in rebellion against God. The ground, God said, is cursed because of you. You will eat from it by means of painful labor all the days of your life. Was that how God intended for it to be? Absolutely not. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and it continues to do that till this very day, doesn't it? Everybody that has a garden understands this curse, because when nothing else will grow, a thistle will grow. You will eat the plants of the field. You will eat bread by the sweat of your brow until you return to the ground, since you were taken from it, for you are dust, and you will return to dust. Was that God's intended plan for you and me? Absolutely not. But this is a set of circumstances that we deal with. Because we are living in a cursed creation. We are under a curse. And then Paul talks about this curse as well in Romans chapter 8. Let's go to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, you know, verse number 18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is going to be revealed to us. So as Christians, what should we expect in this realm, in this life? Suffering. You and I should expect suffering. And why should we expect suffering? Because of the curse. Verse 19, for the creation eagerly waits with anticipation for God's sons to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to futility. Now, just a little bit of extra information. We know that there was a Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible. And we know that's called the Septuagint. And we know that the Septuagint was the version of the Bible that the early church used. Now, the word that Paul uses here in the Greek is the same term that the Greek Septuagint uses in its translation of Ecclesiastes. So in essence, what Paul is saying here is that creation was also subjected to hevel. Not willingly, but because of him who subjected it. In the hope that the creation itself will also be set free from the bondage of corruption into the glorious freedom of God's children. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together with labor pains until now. You and I are under a curse. We will be under that curse until God takes us home or until Christ comes that final time and everything is made right. Let's talk about this for a moment. If God is merciful, why this curse? If God's love is unconditional, then why this curse? If God is so gracious, why this curse? Because if God is so merciful, if he's so gracious, if his love is unconditional, why would he do this? Why would he put a curse on all of his creation, on all of humanity? What's the logic in all of that? How can that be? It is because he is holy. Curse exists because God is holy. And humanity has sinned against him. And there is no excuse for that. So when your family and your friends talk about God's mercy and his grace and his reckless and unconditional love, ask them that question. If God is all loving, then why does this curse still exist? And the answer to that question is because God is holy. God is holy. So, this is the situation that we find ourselves in. We are in a sin-sick, cursed world. So then the next question is, since we find ourselves in this particular set of circumstances, is there a God-given way to enjoy life in this realm? If God is good, and it's still God's desire to display His goodness to you and me, is it possible, given our situation, that we can enjoy life in this realm? And the answer to that question is yes. Because God is good, He still wants you and I to enjoy life in this realm. And in fact, God has given us a way in which we can and should enjoy life in this realm. So here's the question then. Is there a God-given way to enjoy life in this realm? Or is it left up to man to decide for himself how he ought to live life in this realm and how he ought to enjoy life in this realm? Is this something that God has laid out for us like He has in all other aspects? Or is this something that He has left for you and me to decide? Solomon has the answer to that question here in our text this morning. In Ecclesiastes chapter 2, we'll go back there now. In verse 3, you'll remember, what Solomon said there, Ecclesiastes 2, 3. I explored with my mind how to let my body enjoy life with wine and how to grasp folly. My mind still guided me with wisdom until I could see what is good. Now in your outline this morning, I put in parentheses Hebrew word there pronounced as tov. It's spelled T-O-V, but the V is pronounced as a V. The Hebrew word tov, which means good. When God created the heavens and the earth, each day as He evaluated His work, God said, it is tov. Which means it accomplished its purpose. Every day, God said, it was tov. And what Solomon was looking at in chapter 2 and verse 3, he was trying to figure out what was tov for people to do under heaven during the few days of their lives. So once again, this was Solomon looking at life horizontally, looking at life in this realm without taking into consideration God and God's intended purposes for mankind. And what was Solomon's conclusion? It was heaven. It was futile. It was not good. You see, Hevel stands in contrast to Tov. Now, here's what we see in our text for this morning. I put in your outline for you a more literal word-for-word translation of Ecclesiastes 2:24 to help us to understand what Solomon is trying to communicate. So, This is what the Holman said. Ecclesiastes 3:24. There is nothing better for man than to eat, drink, and enjoy his work. Well, here's my translation. Nothing is good, for man than to eat and to drink, and his soul because that's exactly the word that Solomon uses, but none of your English translations say that. Now you may have a footnote in your Holman translation that says that. But Solomon says, and his soul see good, in his work, amal. And that's the word that we looked at 2 weeks ago. So Solomon is saying here that he has examined everything that the world has to offer. And on the basis of life in this cursed, sin-sick world, for the purpose of self-satisfaction, everything is hevel. But what Solomon is about to tell us is that when we live life according to the purpose of God, then things will be good. They will be good, and thus we can enjoy life in this realm. Now here's what to me really stands out and is really significant. When Solomon says his soul. Because this term removes it from the physical realm and takes it into the spiritual realm. And I've got to confess to you today, as I dug into this, in my studies of this, this became a watershed moment. Because what Solomon is saying here is that ultimately everything that we have must be viewed from a spiritual perspective and what spiritual worth it has. And that what we choose to do with what we've been given has a major impact on our spiritual life. God does not expect just 10% from you and me. He expects everything. He expects everything to be used for his glory and for his honor. If you'll remember from our discussion 2 weeks ago, the noun that Solomon uses in Ecclesiastes is translated as efforts, struggles, work and labor. And remember, this is work that goes beyond providing for basic needs. This is the context of our text this morning. Elsewhere in the Old Testament, it is translated as hardship and trouble. And the noun can also be used to indicate the product of one's toil. And we talked about that 2 weeks ago. And more specifically, he's talking about the leftovers. And he's still talking about the leftovers here in this text this morning. And here's something else that we need to know. that impacts how we look at this particular scripture. Within the Hebrew Bible, the word that we have translated as see, sometimes means to realize or to conclude. And that too has a major impact on how we understand Ecclesiastes 2:24. Because what Solomon is trying to communicate is this. That you and I need to be able to look at our lives and see that what we have done with all of our leftovers is that we have used them for the right reason, for the right things. And that makes a huge difference in life. A huge difference in life. And who better to teach us this than Solomon? Had it all and chose not to use what he'd been given by God for God's glory and God's honor. Solomon says everything comes from God's hand, which means it's a gift. Everything ultimately is a gift from God. Here's our spiritual life principle for today. God provides the gifts that produce lasting happiness and joy. Let me ask you this question. Okay? Let's go through our little exercises here. What is man's greatest problem? Sin. What is man's greatest need? Salvation. What is man's greatest pursuit? Holiness. What is man's greatest desire? To glorify God. Let me ask you this question. What's man's greatest gift? Well, number one in your outline this morning says that God is our greatest gift. How many of you were thinking salvation in the back of your mind but was afraid to say it? When I asked you what's your greatest gift, that's okay. That's how we're taught to think, isn't it? We're taught to think that salvation is the greatest gift that God has ever given to humanity. Well, I'm here to tell you this morning that salvation is not the greatest gift that God has given to humanity. The greatest gift that God has given to humanity is God Himself. And think about all that we're missing out on when we don't understand that. What is salvation without God? What is the purpose of salvation? The purpose of salvation is to restore us to God. Because without salvation, we cannot enjoy our greatest gift. The point of salvation is not salvation itself. The point of salvation is putting us back into fellowship with God so that we can enjoy the greatest gift of all, which is God Himself. Now that changes everything, doesn't it? So it's Christmas. How about we focus on our greatest gift? And that's God Himself. Letter A in your outline. God's presence in Eden was man's perfect gift. Have you all found the perfect gift this year? Isn't that what we all look for? That perfect gift to give to somebody? But what was that perfect gift in the Garden of Eden? The presence of God Himself. It wasn't the unlimited free buffet. Now that was good, but that wasn't what made it perfect, was it? What made it perfect was that God was there in a way that you and I have never experienced God. Only Adam and Eve have experienced God in that way. God was the gift. Not the magnificent garden. God Himself. And humanity, we can get so caught up in the bows and the wrapping paper. Isn't it always interesting when a child gets a present? You've thought long and hard and worked hard to get that perfect present for that young one. And that young one gets that package and they tear open the bow and they look at the wrapping paper and they just want to play with the bow. But when they get it all unwrapped, undone, they spend more time playing with the box. I am convinced that one of the best gifts that you can give to a child is an empty box. And they can spend hours entertaining themselves with an empty box. My question to our world today is this. We so consumed with the wrappings that we're not enjoying the greatest gift of all. Letter B. Sin has removed that perfect gift. Because what happened to Adam and Eve in the garden, were they allowed to stay? No, God kicked them out. And what happened to the Garden of Eden? It was destroyed in the flood. So sin keeps us from enjoying that perfect gift. But then we go to letter C. And Christ has restored the possibility of that perfect gift. Because of what Christ has done, there is a possibility that humanity at some point in time can begin to enjoy that perfect gift. Remember, Christmas exists so that Easter can exist. The purpose of Christmas is Easter.
Now, I don't know if the Lord's going to tarry for another year or not. But next year, Christmas Day falls on a Sunday. And I'm wondering how many churches will be closed next Christmas. Because the last time Christmas fell on a Sunday, a lot of churches closed. I wonder if churches will start closing on Easter too, because Easter always falls on a Sunday. Don't be surprised. So we celebrate Christmas so that we can celebrate Easter. But because of what Jesus has done, then there's that possibility of that perfect gift. But here's one of the good things that God has done for us. Letter D. Christ has provided us with a sample. With a sample of that perfect gift. Right now, you and I cannot fully enjoy that perfect gift, but we have a sample. We have a sample of what that perfect gift is like. Now, we've talked about the fact that God is ever present. That's that big fancy word, omnipresence, which means that God is everywhere. There is no place that we can go that God is not there. That is a theological fact. We've also talked about acknowledging the presence of God. God's omnipresence is not a choice of ours. He's there whether we choose to acknowledge Him or not. But that acknowledgement of His presence is our choice. So the question is, letter E, what is mankind going to do? Because mankind has to decide what to do with that sample. And this is the point that Solomon is trying to make here in our text this morning. Because he says in verse 25, because who can eat and who can enjoy life apart from Him? This is a choice. This is something that you and I have to do. This is something that all of humanity has to do. I must confess that I am absolutely nothing without God. I must confess on a daily basis that I have absolutely nothing without God. I must admit to myself and to the world that I am not a self-made man. I must admit to myself and the world that I have accomplished absolutely nothing without God. Everything that I am, everything that I do, everything that I have accomplished, everything I have acquired is a gift from God. And I am being held responsible for what I do with all of those gifts, beginning with me. And yes, that is countercultural.
That doesn't matter. You see, that's the question. It's so much more than the question that we hear asked so many times. What are you going to do with Jesus? Now, that's an important question. It's a good question. But it's not as important as the question, what are we going to do with the gift of God? And that's what I want us to take from the scripture this morning. Because of everything that Solomon has to tell us here in these three verses, this is what's most important. Because who can eat and who can enjoy life apart from Him? So, is there a God-given way in which we can enjoy life in this realm? Yes, there is. Or is it left up to you and I to decide? No. It's not. Solomon chose not to live life according to God's plan. No one has ever tried harder to enjoy life than Solomon. Think about that. Nobody else has ever had the human resources to try to enjoy life in this realm like Solomon had. And what was the message that Solomon continued to share? All of his toils, all of his pursuits under the sun. Heaven. Absolute heaven. Well, now, in the midst of all of this, Solomon gives us a glimpse of hope. And Solomon's going to repeat this message throughout the remainder of this book. What Solomon is telling us here points us to the end of Ecclesiastes. So, church, what is our greatest gift? God is. But also to the world, what is God's greatest gift to the world? Himself. And the world has to decide what they're going to do with that gift. And that has eternal consequences. But you and I, as the church, we also have to decide what we're going to do with that gift, the greatest gift of all, and that choice too, has eternal consequences. Got it? I have much more to say on this topic. Surprise. This is pivotal. What Solomon's saying here is, it's a watershed moment. Because Solomon's saying that our tithe is more than 10%. Our tithe is everything.
Sometimes we live our lives as if we think, well, I've given God my tithe, that's his, and everything else belongs to me. And that I get to choose then what I do with everything else. And that all of that 90%, whether it be resources or time or whatever, that belongs to me to do with whatever I please, as long as I give God this much. That's not what Solomon is saying. Solomon said that when he did that, everything was heaven. Everything was heaven. Solomon gave God his time. Solomon gave God his tenths and much more, but didn't give God everything. That's my Christmas sermon. I did talk about gifts. I'm thankful that this realm is temporary. Because in this realm, I have to make difficult choices. In the world that's to come, I'll have no more difficult choices. Amen? I won't need free will in the realm to come. We live in a throwaway society. We're to the point now where if you buy something and it breaks, you can't find somebody to fix it, so you just go buy a new one. Because it's easier to buy a new one than it is to find somebody to fix what you got that's broke. Eternity lasts forever. We living our life today for eternity? Or are we simply living for today? Do you understand the difference? It's all about God. It's all about God. And if you don't like that, and you want to rebel against that, that's your choice. That's my choice. But that doesn't change the truth. So what you and I have is a choice to accept the truth. I hadn't used this one for a while. Submit to the truth and act upon the truth. So we know the truth. Now we have to make those other choices. But the greatest gift that you and I have is God what will you do with that this week? Will you enjoy that great gift today? Or will we try to pacify ourselves with all the things that this world has to offer? Well, if the greatest gift of all is God, and we can have a sample of that now, why not enjoy that now? So that we can enjoy life in this sin-sick, cursed world. Why wait? Why put it off when you have it all right now? Let's stand and sing. People said,
amen.
All right, tell somebody what they missed today.
Hey, as Jeff mentioned earlier, it's Eats Evening at 6 o'clock. We'll have a children's program. He's planning on attending that, supporting young kids if they work for this program. And then, reminder that Friday evening, we'll have our candlelight service here at 7 o'clock. Note for the ladies, and no Bible study on the next two Mondays nights. We'll be starting back up on January 3rd. Over there where the communion cups are, we have some sign-up sheets there. We have a list of our ministries. There's names listed, people are on those, but if you choose not to do that, you can cross your name off. If you'd like to join that committee, go ahead and put your name on the list there. Also, we have events for 2022 coming up. If you'd like to be a chairman for any of those, please sign up on the paper over there for that. All right. Okay, at this time, Jeff and Rose. All right. We just like to go ahead and we want to thank Jeff and Rose for their work they do here for the Pines. We have a Christmas gift for them. They already know what it is. We're giving them a half hog this year. So they'll have some meat to last them for a while.
Or bacon.
Church might give you a gift here today. We're so thankful for all you do with the treasury stuff, taking care of all the funds and paying all the bills. You guys, I don't think people just realize how much she does on that. She also has a helper. She's not here this morning, but Julie helps her out with that, just making sure everything's in line, everything's in place. So we're really appreciative of that. Like I said, it does take a lot of time, but it's something that has to be done for us. Yes, please stand for our benediction. Thank you that we can be here today, that we have that freedom, that we can come and hear your word. We thank you for the perfect gift of yourself, and at this time of the year especially, that you came to give us that possibility of everlasting life with you. As we go out, we need to go out and remind everyone that they too can have that perfect gift, that they should look to you and not just the fun gift-giving season and Santa Claus and things like that, but why we have this season. In Jesus' name.